Well, hello and a very good morning, a very good afternoon and a very good evening based on the time in which you'll be watching this video. Hello haters, hoping you all are doing well, fine and also keeping yourselves happy, occupied and not taking much undue stress, and also members of your families are doing well, fine. Please try staying happy, try keeping yourselves occupied. Not just with studies, but so many other things, so as to increase upon your knowledge base, so as to get some more exposure to different kinds of activities, different works, and also so as to see where your passions, where your interests lie. Now, while we are talking history, it is, and let us go back. When we were talking in the previous chapter, we were talking of so many things which are happening in the 18th century India. So many different small kingdoms coming up, so many different ways by which one ruler trying to put down another ruler, so many different small kingdoms trying to fight or trying to go against a larger kingdom, the Mughal Empire gradually crumbling or gradually falling down, and this was the situation in the 18th century India. It was a situation of political turmoil. It was not only a turmoil, it was also a situation where there was people were unsure what would be happening next. And this was the time when, well, history, as you say, some things, some events happened, such fell into place so as to give the conditions, or so as to make the conditions proper for everything which we are seeing today. So what happened then was, there was that boom, or there was that immense amount of technological advancement which was going on in Europe. And with those technological advancements came scientific advancements. Scientific advancements made traveling in the seas easier, and there were larger ships now which were moving in the waters, and they started moving, the Europeans, they started moving to different parts of the world. And they went to the different parts of the world in search of newer territories, newer lands to conquer, newer lands to capture, newer resources to have in their hands, so as to start trading with different people. So all of these things were happening in the 18th century. And not only the 18th century, start of the 16th century, 17th century, 18th century, all of these things were happening. And the Europeans, they started moving to different places. They came to India also. And they came to India as traders. The English were the last to arrive in India. Before the English, the French had come, the Dutch had come, the Portuguese had come. The Portuguese were the first to come to India. It was Vasco da Gama who landed somewhere near Calicut. Now Calicut, the name was given Calicut because of a fine quality of fine cloth that is known as calico. Calico is a very fine cloth, and it was found in those areas of Calicut. So from calico came Calicut. So he landed over there, Calicut. The modern day name or the Indian version of it is Kozhikode, where you had that disaster of that plane which came in from Dubai, and it met with a fateful accident. So, that is where Kozhikode, Calicut, and that is where Vasco da Gama landed with his ships, with his crews, and he came. He took so many spices, he traded with us, he took so many spices, went back to Portugal, went back to Europe, and then he sold all those things at profit, huge profits. And seeing this, so many different traders started coming. When there were so many trade unions, the governments of those countries, they understood one thing. These traders and the trades which will be happening with the Americas, the trades which will be happening with the Asians, all these trades will be making the governments rich. So the governments, they started forming different associations. They started forming different companies so as to look particularly into the trading sections, or so as to help with the trades which were happening with different countries. The countries came up with so many companies. Examples, there were the Dutch East India Company, the French East India Company, and the British East India Company. Why the East India and the West India? When we talk of the West Indies, as it was, you have a country, so West Indies, because it was lying to the west of the European nations, to the west America. Christopher Columbus came out in search of India, but eventually he found out America, And he understood that, okay, so I've come to the West. So this is the India in the West. That is why he called it the West Indies. And you understand now how important India was in those times. People came out in search of India. And it was for the search of India that America got accidentally discovered. So you have the West Indies there. The East Indies is referred to the areas around Indonesia. That is the East Indies. And we have the East India, or the areas over here, or the Indian subcontinent and the other Asian trading places, the Malay Peninsula or Malay Archipelago, which we have over there, the Malaysia over there, Sumatra, we have Thailand, then we also have the Chinese, the trades with the Chinese in the South China Sea. So all of these trading things were being looked by after the East India companies of the different countries. So when we talk of East India Company, it is not only the British East India Company. All the different countries had their own East India Companies. We had the French East India Company, we had the Dutch East India Company, we had the English East India Company. But this British East India Company was the one which survived for the longest and which had made, or which made a lasting effect on the Indian subcontinent, went on to eventually rule over India. But it was not so in the start. The British East India Company came to India just so as to trade, and this trading concession was granted to Sir Thomas Rowe. Sir Thomas Rowe was a parliamentarian in England, and he came to the court of Jahangir. After lots and lots of negotiation and after lots of pleadings to Jahangir, the East India Company was finally granted a trading concession and the trading privilege. Now, the East India Company was set up in 1600. It came to be formed in the year 1600, and it was set up by a Carter. Carter is an official document which deals with something or which tells about something. So that official document, the Carter, was signed by Queen Elizabeth, and she was ruling over England back then. And this, it was Queen Elizabeth. I do get confused between Queen Elizabeth, Queen Victoria. So Queen Elizabeth, she signed the Carter. And this Carter, after this Carter or this proclamation was signed, the East India Company came into being. And this East India Company started trading with India. And in the initial years, the East India Company did not give as much profit as it was thought to be giving, because East India Company was having to compete with the other well-established companies. The Dutch East India Company, or the Dutch East Indies Company, and the French East India Company. So all of these were trading from, all of these were trading earlier than the British. So they had a different hold over the Indian trade. The Britishers gradually started getting into the Indian business, or into the business of trading with India. And they started setting up factories. The first factory which came up was in Surat. Surat is in there in Gujarat, in present-day Gujarat. And factories were nothing but godowns, actually. Factories do not mean the modern day factory. Where a modern day factory means there is some manufacturing going on, there are so many different machines. So that was not the factory. Factory was, during those times, there were those areas where the factors lived. Factors were nothing but the Europeans or the Britishers who came so as to trade with India and who were looking after the trade with India. They were the company officials, they were the company factors. So where the factors live, it was the factories. They were nothing but the godowns. And it was in those areas, if you go to any port area, or if you go to any trader, what you will be finding is that the trader keeps some of his trading items, trading materials, trading goods on the outside, on display, or maybe which is being traded. And most of his inventory or most of his goods will be kept somewhere in a reserve, that is the godown. So you can imagine a similar kind of a thing over there in the factories also. Factories were nothing but godowns where all the goods which were to be traded were being kept. There were so many people, so many officials who were working over there, looking after all those goods, looking after the trades, looking after the accounts. So these were factors, these were factories. And different factories started coming up in different parts of India. Madras, Calcutta, Calcutta came up much later. It was Hooghly first. Then you had Surat, Mumbai came much later. You had Masulipatnam, which is there in Andhra Pradesh. So all these factories, these started coming up. And the Britishers, in the starting years, what used to happen was that for maybe 100 or 150 years, the Britishers, they used to bring in What do you need for trade? You need, so as to trade, so as to buy something from someone, you need to give them something in return. So the Britishers, they brought European materials, they brought European items for trade to India, but mostly what they brought was gold and silver bullion. In today's market, we trade in dollars. The inter-country trade happens in dollars, but back then it used to happen in gold bullion. And gold and silver was the main exchange items. So if you had to, suppose you are an Indian, I am an official of the British East India Company, so I'll be coming to you, I'll be taking your good from you, and I'll be paying you the value of that good in terms of gold or silver, bullion as in the bricks or big bars of gold and silver. So when they were trading, they used to bring in ships loaded with gold and silver bullion. They used to come to India, they used to trade with the Indian traders, take back or take Indian spices, take Indian clothing and take Indian other goods. We had a few very important goods like ivory, like there was the horns of the rhinos. Those were not actually good things to trade in, but they were in huge demand in the European countries. Then we had the spices, we had the different types of silks, we had the cotton. So all of these, and then we had the textiles which are being made by from these materials, silk and cotton. So all of these things were used to, or all of these things were being traded. And the Britishers came with their ships loaded with bullion and gold, gold and silver, and used to give it to the Indians and take away Indian goods and sell it over there, not only in Europe but in different parts of the world, or in those places where the Europeans were trading. So this was actually the initial arrangement which was there. It would have been the same had not the Mughal Empire disintegrated. But as the Mughal Empire started disintegrating, what started happening was that different smaller kingdoms started coming up. We discussed it in the previous chapter. And with the rise of these different kingdoms and with the rise of small kingdoms, there was no central power to hold the whole country together. And the Britishers, they were being requested. The Britishers were being requested, not only the British East India Company and the French East India Company, these two companies, they were maintaining their own armies. Now, first thing, why did they need to maintain an army? They started maintaining an army because when you are trading with so much amount, or when you are trading in so much, so when you are trading with so much amount of good, what actually happens is that with the trade, or with so much good, you do require some kind of security or some people who will be looking after all those interests and the trade. So the Britishers, they had their own army, the French, they had their own small army, so as to look after the, or so as to protect their interests in India. And these armies were well trained, they were having proper ammunitions, proper arms, armaments, and these armies were very efficient. So the Indian rulers, in order to defeat other Indian rulers, they started seeking out help from the Britishers, from the French, and gradually India became the playfield for the French and the Britishers. The French and the Britishers, they had their own fights over there, here in India, in the form of the Carnatic Wars. And after the end of the Carnatic Wars, it was British East India Company which came out as the ultimate ruler of India, or ultimate master of India, and the French were relegated the second position, or the inferior position, than that of the British East India Company, and gradually India came under the rule of the Britishers. How this came to be, or what were the different, or how this thing happened, how they became from traders to rulers, all of these things will be covered in this book, or in this chapter, or in the upcoming videos. Till then, please take care, stay safe, be safe, and stay happy. Thank you.